Welcome to a top 10 countdown with the Nitpicking Nerds.
In this video, we're going over the 10 commanders that are the least fun to play against.
I'm your host, Joe Cherries.
I'm your host, Beezy, and that makes us the Nitpicking Nerds. Joe, we're going to get right into this list. Why don't you tell us what the criteria for it is?
The criteria for this list is these are the least fun commanders. You sit down at the table, your opponents start pulling out their decks, you see this commander, you immediately want to cringe because you know that most likely the deck built with this commander is cringy. Or maybe even just the commander itself, it doesn't matter.
We're excluding CDH. If you sit down at a CDH game, you're just playing CDH, so there's nothing to be complaining about. I don't really think those mix and match games really happen. So that's not a problem. It's not like, oh, I'm worried about this infinite combo or that infinite combo. It's like, this is the effect the commander has in the game, and it's really annoying.
Yes.
What's number 10?
Number 10 is Kambal, Council of Allocations. He's a 2/3 for one white black. I believe he's a human advisor. Not positive about that, but I'm pretty sure. And whenever an opponent casts a non-creature spell, they take 2 damage and you gain 2 life. Now, this is number 10 for a reason because it's not the most annoying, but if you sit down, especially with a Spellslingers type of deck, you're going to go, God, he's so annoying.
He's one of those creatures where he's annoying enough that you feel it, but you don't really ever want to like waste a removal spell, especially when he's in the command zone because they'll just play him again. And you kind of just have to fight through it. It's frustrating. It's pretty frustrating. Yeah. I didn't expect it to be, but it's like actually really annoying.
Yeah, we've played against this card many a times. One of our friends has a Kambal deck. And it's not like this is like, I hate this deck. I will never play against this.
Trust me, the ones on the higher up, they get way less fun. This is kind of like number 10, we got a flex slot almost. We get to just, you know what's annoying? This guy.
I don't like playing as Kambal could be very frustrating when you're trying to, it's like, I want to cast like 3 spells this turn, but I'll take 6 damage.
Yeah, especially if they build into the tax thing where they make you pay life for other reasons, then it's just like, okay, come on.
Yeah, I want to cast, your cantrips become so costly.
Oh, yeah. They're like unplayable.
I'll get probe you, pay 4 life.
You have to pay 2 at least. You can't ever spend a blue mana or you're not getting your value.
Exactly.
All right, number 9. You play this commander, so I'll let you read it.
It's Yuriko, the Tiger's Shadow. It costs 1 blue-black for a 1/3 with Commander Ninjutsu. When you have an unblocked creature, you can pay black and blue to put that creature into your hand and put this in its place. And whenever a ninja you control deals combat damage to a player, reveal the top card of your library. Each opponent loses life equal to its CMC and then put it in your hand.
So yeah, when you said this costed 1 black blue, you misspoke. It costs black blue only ever because for some reason they wanted to give it specifically Ninjutsu, Commander Ninjutsu, and they didn't want it, but like it's not taxable. The commander tax does not apply. It's very annoying.
Yeah.
It feels like you're kind of like getting away with something because that's not fun. There's no like tension. It's like always, if you unblock, never don't block anything, always this hits, you take it. You can't, if I attack with 3 creatures, you can't remove one. I'm going to Ninjutsu the other one. Like if I Ninjutsu in Yuriko and then you kill Yuriko, I'll just Ninjutsu it again before combat. And then you take the damage again.
Yeah.
Or anyway.
Another thing about that is like better way of explaining what he's saying is you attack with 2 creatures. They're both unblocked. One is Yuriko. One is a 1/1 unblockable. They kill Yuriko. Now Yuriko is dead back in the command zone. You now pay the commander Ninjutsu to put it back in play, put the other card in your hand, and you're in the same place and you're just going to get the trigger anyway.
It's just annoying. I don't think that's how it should work. It doesn't feel like, that's not how any other commander works really.
No.
Maybe one, but I think it might show up here.
This isn't really how many other commanders work. There's tax on commanders. When you cheat tax, it tends to be extremely annoying.
This is more frustrating because it's so recent. Like they just missed. They shouldn't have done this.
They chose to do that. They chose to print this card. And
okay. Originally, a couple of the other ones like Eloro, that's not on this list, but I get like maybe that was a mistake doing Eminence. Mm-hmm. But then it's like they did that. Okay, well, don't do it again. They did it again. Why are you doing it again?
All right. So that's Yuriko, but what's next? This is one that you can read.
Oh, yeah. Number 8 is Memnarch. 7 mana for a 4/5 legendary artifact creature wizard. 1 blue, colon. Target permanent becomes an artifact in addition to its other types. That does not go away. 3 and a blue. Gain control of target artifact. Eat your heart out, Dak Faden. I think Memnarch might be the greatest thief in the multiverse. What were you saying?
He's extremely annoying. They're going to be playing things like liquid metal coating in the deck to turn your things into artifacts. Then they're going to pay 4 mana to steal your stuff. This is a steal the stuff off the board deck.
In a training grounds. Running amok.
You're also stealing permanents.
Yeah, you're stealing permanents. It's indefinite. It's kind of like What did we say stealing a permanent was? Is it 2-for-1 or 3-for-1? I mean, you're not even paying a card. I don't know. It's like it's incalculable. Yep. How blown out you're getting when they steal your like your tapped Hedron Archive or something that's already an artifact and they don't even have to do anything.
Just
mono blue ramps, take all your ramp, ramps them into it more so that the tax doesn't even matter that much.
Now he's a 7-mana commander, so he's lower on this list because if this, again, the one mana one one
rule we like to bring up. This was a 1-mana 1/1, it would be banned.
Yeah. We should do that list.
The list, best 1-mana 1/1 commanders.
If you make the commander a 1-mana 1/1, which ones are the absolute best? I think
we talked about it in person, but we haven't talked about it on the channel.
No, we haven't. I think that'd be interesting. Memnarch is up there because he's insane.
Yeah.
Because like if you can just pay 5 mana basically to get something right away, oh, disgusting.
Right. Well, anyway, weird hypotheticals aside. Number 7 is the card we just mentioned with Yuriko. It's Darevi, the original Imperial Tactician. Her fake cost is green, white, blue for a 2/3 flying. When it enters the battlefield or a creature you control deals combat damage to a player, you may tap or untap target permanent. And you can pay her actual cost, 1 and a bant, : put her onto the battlefield from the command zone. That can be used whenever, has flash, can't be countered unless it's the counter and activated ability. I hate it.
Again, you're avoiding commander attacks, are completely annoying. But on top of avoiding commander attacks, this deck,
text on this card is worse.
The text on this card says play stacks because when you play stasis, you just get to keep untapping your land so other players aren't going to be able to untap.
Or like static orb or something, or Winter Orb is untapped, and then it's tapped when you go to untap, and then your lands don't get applied. It's super annoying. Whether or not this is stacks, it doesn't have to be. Just this is going to never not be in play. And it's kind of like Yuriko. You can just put a bunch of cheap, dumb, unblockable creatures and take like almost extra turns when you hit everybody, because then you get all your lands untapped.
I mean, Darevi pushes you to play stacks. Like it's not like most commanders where it's like, this is a stacks commander. No, he says, if you're playing stacks, you get a huge advantage because I'm not going to make the stacks apply to you.
Yeah, really huge. It makes them all one-sided if Derevi's out, which why wouldn't it be? Because it has no commander tax and it has flash and it costs 4 mana.
Yeah, well, completely fair. Everyone loves Derevi. I don't think I've sat down from a Derevi deck across the table, but I don't think I'd be happy.
Maybe this is a little late, but I will say right now, I actually don't like hate any of these cards, but when you're making at least fun, I do think these are the least fun, but I'll never tell somebody they can't play a commander. Well, it's kind of like in the back of my head, I'm thinking, wow, this is annoying.
I mean, yeah. I mean, you play this next commander.
Or to the point where I might even say, hey, let's switch up the decks. Like that's the most I would ever do with any of these. But number 6, you can read it because I read 2 in a row.
It's Thresios, Triton's Hero. Blue green for a 1/3. He's a merfolk legendary. I don't know what his other type is. Do you know what?
He's a merfolk troll.
He's a troll. He's not a wizard. Ah, okay. So you can pay 4 mana, scry 1, then reveal the top card of your library. If it's a land, put it on the battlefield tap. Otherwise, put it in your hand.
This was so unassuming, I think, the first time. Because no, we didn't really know what partner was. He has partner. But we're not talking about him paired with anyone in particular. It's just Thrasios. Not because it goes infinite or you're probably playing Fish Hulk. It's just the card Thrasios is very irritating. It ends up working out that if you don't have anything to do with your mana, you just don't do anything and you pass and you pay 8 and then you just put 2 lands in play.
Yeah, and at the same time of also leaving it up, you're leaving up any instants you have in your hand as well.
He fuels himself, which is kind of annoying. And then if I've had, like I play a janky, like a terror, like the deck is not good, but it's Thrasios is one of the commanders and that is like such a crutch sometimes.
Yeah.
Where I'm like, okay, I have 12 lands because I ramped really good, but they've wiped my board and I have nothing to do. All right, play Thrasios for 4 mana, go. End of turn, draw 2, untap, pass, draw 3. Now I have action again.
Yeah, Thrasios is extremely annoying again because you can just keep refueling. And he has the partner mechanic, which I think is already an annoying mechanic in itself. I absolutely cannot stand it.
Yeah, honestly. I didn't really notice that, but there's a couple of like commander precon exclusive annoying mechanics that are in here. Yeah,
and partner is one of my least favorite ones. I absolutely am just not a fan.
Yeah, there was a way. Partner feels like companion. There was a way to do it. That was less annoying.
Well, we already know what the way to do it is. Partner with was the proven.
Partner with is sweet.
The proven and worked way to like make partner.
I mean, there's a way to do partners. They're just like, they're so like all over the place with power.
I mean, Thrasios is just way too good for what he.
I mean, some of the partners, they're fine. Like Akiri, that card's cool.
What's the blood sower?
Timna?
Tana.
Tana's cool.
Yeah.
They're just totally normal cards. But then you print like Thrasios and Timna and a couple of the other ones just end up being like way better.
Yeah, silly. Partner, they need to be like lower.
We want Ikra Shiddiqui. We don't want like Chrom where it's just like, hey, draw some cards.
Yeah, exactly.
Number five is Prosh, Sky Raider of Care. Wow, another recent pre-con exclusive. And by recent, I mean from 7 years ago. Three and a Jund for a 5/5 flyer. It's a legendary dragon. When you cast Prosh, create X01 kobold creature tokens, where X is the amount of mana spent to cast Prosh as flying. Sacrifice another creature, Prosh gets +1/+0. So that basically is just throw away. Although, you know, you could commander damage somebody, but it's a free sack outlet, and it gives you at least 6 bodies. You can't stop it.
These are all O1s that you're going to be able to sack, take advantage of, because your deck is going to be built to take advantage of these. Something like a Purphoros is just silly. Purphoros is hard to remove from the battlefield. He sits there, so now you're like, okay, I have 12 mana. My Prosh has died twice to board wipe.
Right, you have the irritating part that gets you. It's like you have to kill Prosh, and then when you kill it, you regret killing it because they're going to get
more guys,
more dudes.
Yeah, and something like I said, Purphoros is sitting there saying, you can't kill me.
You take 18 damage when they play that Prosh for the third time.
Absolutely.
Oh my god. How are you supposed to do
18 damage to everybody? It's 54 damage.
It's not just like that. You play like the janky ones. You play Impact Tremors, you play Blood Artist, then you sack them and you get double damage with, you know, those two like static effects. And it just ends up being something you can't really interact with. That's the main irritating part. Like that's the probably what ties all these together, is it's hard to interact with and it'll change the game.
Yeah, I mean, Prosh, again, it's a cast trigger. Cast triggers are tough. When you're playing it, like, if they cast it, it happens. Unless you have, like, Stifle, which is unplayable.
Right. I mean, I'm not playing Disallow. I'm not playing Void Slime. You really can't even make me play those cards. I'm just not going to do it.
I could make you. I could just, like, take one of your decks and just, like, slide one in.
That'd be weird. I don't condone that.
Why not?
I just want to go on to the next one, honestly.
Okay.
Number four.
You don't condone it because you want to move on.
I am in a YouTube video right now. Number four is Zakama, Primal Calamity.
6 and a Naya for a legendary Elder Dinosaur. 9/9, Vigilance, Reach, Trample. When he enters the battlefield, if you cast it, untap all lands you control. 2, red, Zakama deals 3 damage to target creature. 2, green, destroy target artifact or enchantment. 2, white, you gain 3 life. I almost have 5 because...
You're thinking Kenrith?
Kenrith, yeah. Mm-hmm. That was what I was thinking of.
Well, this card doesn't look annoying, and you kind of have to play against it, I think. Because the first time I played against it, I'm like, this is just a dinosaur deck. Because it was just a janky tribal dinosaur deck. And it was like, oh my god, Zakama is the most annoying thing ever.
So you're playing a deck that ramps all land. So when you play him, he's going to come down and untap. So now he has 3 activations of any kind. He's going to blow up the best 3 artifacts, the smallest creatures, and maybe even just pay 9 mana to destroy the biggest, baddest Elishnorn or something like that.
You could. It's just Zakama kind of comes down and it's like a destroy the best thing every opponent controls. And then if it untaps, like it's another one of those where you play so much ramp that you're just going to cast it all the time. And it just gets better and better every time. And the board ends up just being clear. Every time I play against Zakama, the board is just clear except for Zakama. And then maybe you kill it, maybe you don't.
Yeah, Zakama absolutely overruns the board and like just takes the game over.
That's what it just ends up being, like the game gets stale. Zakama just kills everything.
Yeah, he grinds the game to a halt. Like the game could be going, like there could be tons of stuff going on the board, but then he just comes on and he's like, well, if you're not playing a Spell Slinger deck, get rid of that, get rid of that, get rid of that.
And you don't have an answer, or if you don't have an answer. Obviously, most of these are if you don't have an answer, because if you do, but some of them you can't have an answer to. But anyway, if you don't have an answer, you really can't play stuff because it will just die.
Yeah. Code is completely and utterly bonkers on the board.
It's super good.
Yeah.
It's one of those, if you want to build a fun deck, I think you'll have less fun than you wanted to.
Ooh, this is one of the best 1-mana 1/1s.
This is a decent 1-mana 1/1.
It combos so easily.
Well, I mean, literally so are all these, because it only gets more and more insane as we go up. So what's number 3?
Narset, Enlightened Master.
3 and a Jeskai for a 3/2 first strike hexproof. When she attacks, you exile top 4 cards in your library, and now any of them that are non-creatures, you can just cast them for free.
So here's the problem with this deck and with this commander. No matter how you build your Narset deck.
Right. We always talk about, hey, this is so cool. I want to trigger Narset a million times. Like, I would like to do this more because it's cool and I want to do it. Like, I can't blame somebody for wanting to do what their commander says. But when you do this, you take time warps and you take extra combats, and then the opponents either don't get a turn or wait for you to fizzle, and you only dealt like 15 damage and that was your turn. This just ends up being a huge waste of time. It's so hard to interact with because it is hexproof, but it is 6 mana, so it's not like the boogeyman that it used to be. People used to like flip over this, but now it's kind of, I mean, with all these other things.
I mean, yeah, you just have to have one player free. You ramp yourself into this, you play it as early as you possibly can, you start hitting, and you just go off. it's not creatures, so there's a lot of awesome things you can hit. Again, you want to build the deck. So it's like, I want to do what my deck is built to do what Narset does. And what Narset does, it's insane.
It's overrun the game and kind of like make this selfish, like, it's all about me now. I hope you like my turn because it's going to be that for a long time.
Yeah, it's like you're putting, even in your cool janky one, you're throwing in your omniscience because why are you not? Because that's awesome.
Yeah, it's just cool. But it just ends up Narset. Like, the deck might be cool, but Narset is the irritating part.
It's like, yeah, especially because it has Hexproof. That is going to be the most...
There's not a lot of commanders I will conspire against, but I will conspire against a Narset resolving. I'll say, like, hey, we need to, like, leave up a counterspell because then we get a free pass, then we wait till they have 8 mana, and then maybe we can do something.
Yeah.
But I don't want...
Oh, if they have Boots Out...
Yeah, if they have Boots Out or Greaves, you got to do something.
Yeah, don't let that commander come hit the field, because if it hits you, it could literally end the game.
Yeah, or they copy the triggered abilities, so, like, they're never missing.
I don't want to talk about that.
Yeah, nasty. But these next two are so much nastier than that. What is number two, since you hate it so much?
It's Emrakul, the Promised End. It's a 13-13 for 13. It costs one less for each type among cards in your graveyard. It has flying. It has trample. It has protection from instants. And when you cast it, you get to take control of target opponent's next turn, and they get an extra turn after that one.
Let me tell you, the extra turn does not make up for the fact that they just lost the game.
It is absolutely completely devastating. If you have any way to pay life in increments of one or two, if it's your life total, you're dead.
If your life total is even and you have a pay two life, do something, you lose. Necropones, you lose. Demonic Tutor and Necropones in your deck, you lose. It's just, there's so many little small things that mean you lose right now. And then there's the, okay, I can't kill them right now. Well, you lose all your creatures. You're going to discard all your cards. Like, if you have ways to draw cards, what I found is the best is you go off with their deck. And then you just don't do the payoff, or you do the payoff and kill everyone but yourself, the person who cast Emrakul. Like, I've done the, all right, go infinite with Karmic Guide and Revelark, kill you, and then I will kill myself.
Yeah, shoot. Yeah, the Emrakul is an insanely...
It's also a bully card. You have to pick one person, and then that person just doesn't get to play very much.
That's actually what I was going to say. Yeah,
and everyone else does.
I hate being targeted with this card. I hate having my turn control. It just feels so devastating every single time. And it's not even just devastating. It's just unfun. It takes you out of the game. And a lot of times, if you don't have that pay life, without killing you. So now you just have to sit at the table with, like, one card at your hand and go ahead.
Yeah, like, oh, they use my turn to draw 14 cards, but then they discard it down to 7 lands. So, like, what am I supposed to do?
So when I sit, like, I've not sat across from this in the command zone, but I would be extremely annoyed to sit across from it down in the command zone.
I've never sat across from this because I don't think it's a lot of fun to play with as the commander. It's probably really stale, so I don't see a lot. But if I did, I would have to, like, we'd have to take some steps. We'd have to be like, all right, guys, do you see that? Because I see that. It's like an 8-mana 13-13 that when you kill it, they get to do it again. You have to, like, not kill it somehow.
Imprison it in the moon.
You imprison it in the moon because...
You got a flavor win
to kill it. It is going to own you. Yes.
Yeah, that is actually a flavor win.
That's like the only way to stop it.
Yeah.
You have to, like, turn it into a bug or a plant or a moon.
A bug, a plant, or a moon.
Yeah.
Emrakul, turn into a bug.
All right. Well, the least fun commander, at least if you're talking about what we think. Obviously, this is all our opinion. I think every sentence ever uttered can be prefaced with, in my opinion. But Tulane, Teller of Tales, is number one. The least fun commander to see across the table. Two, green, white, blue for a legendary creature, Human Druid. He's a 2/4 with vigilance. Whenever you cast a creature spell, draw a card. Then you may put a land card from your hand onto the battlefield. 3, tap. Return target creature you control to its owner's hand. This is a 5-mana. He's a little bit clunky, but hey, you're probably going to win if you get to do anything with this card.
If you untap with this card, it's hard not to put yourself in such a commanding position, even with the most innocent version of a Tulane deck.
We've seen the innocent versions where our friend's like, I like Tulane, but he looks really strong. I'm going to keep it very light and just build, like, this janky deck full of creatures I like. Yeah, he still destroyed everybody.
I mean, it's just, he comes down. If he's not answered, especially, and you untap with, like, 5 or 6 mana, it's silly. You go one drop, draw a card, put a land in play.
The land is untapped.
The land is untapped.
So they replace it. The one drop replaces itself with the card and with the mana.
And, like, if you have a way to give, like, your dorks haste, like, you have even more mana. You can just keep playing things over and over.
My least favorite part about this card is that it bounces itself. Did not have to bounce itself.
Did not have to bounce itself. I mean, that doesn't even affect.
It probably doesn't come up a ton, but once it's out, like, maybe you died and then you played it. Now, if you untap, it's just, you're never going to activate it because it doesn't do anything other than protect itself. And you're just going to say, It doesn't have commander text anymore.
And again, this is the classic, I want to do again. We're coming back to it. I want to do what my commander wants to do. So I put things like Wirewood Symbiote to do the cool bounces. And now I'm absolutely going off and destroying
everybody. You just don't ham. And you don't have to be – like this is like a competitive deck too. But the competitive deck isn't too far off of what I've seen of like janky like one mana one ones.
No, it is. It's basically the same thing. Where
it feels just kind of competitive no matter what you do with it.
Yeah.
Unless you're playing Instant Sorcery.
What I was saying was like the way that it differs is like inside that deck, there's a food chain and more tutors.
Yeah.
That's the difference. But like also it just has a bunch of 1/1 dorks. So once it gets a commander out, it can just do the same thing that every two lane deck.
It's just like Zakama. It just ramps into more of itself too.
It just never stops going off. And like the only way that this card isn't going off is if they have like one card in your hand. So you can actually hope they brick. Because if they hit a land, then they're not doing a spell.
Yeah, if they had a bunch of lands, they can brick. But this is like an accidental wombo combo commander. Julian is so good.
I don't know. Again, I've sat across from it many a times, and I've not been. It's just annoying. It's
I just know so that I have annoying. To kill it, or I'm probably going to lose.
It's like, I wasn't mad because some of the versions were CDH decks. Like,
no, it doesn't. That's irrelevant.
That was irrelevant to the conversation. It was like, okay, he didn't do anything, but now Chulang's just going off and absolutely winning the game by itself because it's so silly.
Most of these commanders can do that, just win the game by themselves.
Yes, pretty much. As long as you have some way to take advantage of it in your deck, which when you build a deck, you build around your commander.
Yeah, this very much feels like, you know, most of these, at least, you know, Campbell doesn't fit most of these boxes, but it feels like there's just such a disparity at the table when you choose commanders, if one of them is Emrakul or Zakama or Parash, where you just get so much stuff for free that it feels like you've been slighted as the opponent. It feels like you're not, it's not fair.
As I say, I've never felt slighted.
Not slighted, like, ha, ha.
I felt slighted the other day.
That was a weird noise. I don't know what I was going.
Yeah, I don't know where you're going with it either. But that's the end of the video. That's our list of the top 10 least fun commanders to sit across from.
Absolutely. Or diagonal from.
Or directly next to.
Or on top of.
I don't know. It probably feels good to like step on a Chulang.
Okay. If you like the video, I'm going to need you to comment. Actually, I'm going to need you. No, you're going to have to comment right now. Just tell us what you thought. Who's the worst one on this list? Or did we get it wrong? Or what are your opinions? What is your list?
I would love, I want to see who you're like. This is the one I hate. If I sit across from this one, I hate it the most.
Yeah, like what really just gets your blood boiling? Even if it's for no reason, I kind of just want to hear it. I mean, we respond to every single comment because we like talking to people.
That's not true. We respond to 98% of comments.
Like every single constructive comment that's not like a bot or someone just saying, you guys are ugly. Like we'll respond to, oh, you know what? I'll even respond to those for this one time only. Whoever the first person is, tell me that I'm ugly, I'll respond to. But we respond to all the comments. We want to talk to the fans. I like hearing people think, I like bouncing ideas off each other. Helps us get new ideas for videos, and it's just awesome interacting with the fan base. So,
yeah, exactly. And if you would like to support us, there are three ways to do it. The first one is patreon.com/user/nitpickingnerds. That's where you can go to join our Patreon. You get into our Discord. There's also some other awesome perks. We love all of our patrons as much as we can without making them uncomfortable. They're great. They're awesome. They're pretty much the best people that exist on this planet.
I mean, they support the show almost single-handedly.
Do you want to be as awesome? Do you want to be one of the best people on the planet? Because it's so easy. All you have to do is support us on patreon.com.
Or through these other two means. You can also go to buymeacoffee.com. It's just a digital tip jar where it makes you stutter sometimes. Digital tip jar. You can throw some money in there if you really like what we're doing. And you're like, hey, it's like seeing a guy on the street play guitar. It's like, that's pretty good. Throw it.
I want to be clear. If you give us a tip, you're pretty awesome, but you're not as cool as our patrons.
Wow.
I'm just saying. I mean, you're awesome. I love you, and I will give you a hug.
I love you.
And I will give you a hug, but you're no patron.
Gee, like Tombstone, you're no patron. You're no patron at all. Okay. The last way is to go to the TCG Player link we have for you in the description. It's going to take you to the TCG Player site, except with a twist, anything you buy from then on forward – in the site gives us a kickback and you don't have to spend extra money because the stuff you wanted anyway.
Yeah.
Free roll.
And you guys have absolutely been using that link awesomely. We've been getting some kickback, throwing it back into the channel, obviously, because there are mics.
Big changes coming. They're literally around us. We have the new mics. We just need to wait for a couple more pieces of equipment to come in and it'll be together and we'll have new mics. It'll be amazing. We got the camera. So we got the mics. And when we move, we're getting the studio. So we'll be like big boys then.
Yeah, big boys. This is all coming together so well. It's so frustrating because we got all the stuff in, and every time we think we're ready to put the new mics in,
some like weird wrinkle happens.
Yeah, we need a piece we didn't think about. We need a cord. We rip and break cords, specifically us and nobody else.
Certainly nobody who went to help with us with it. But this video's over. That basically qualified as a tidbit about our life. So we can move on and let you guys go enjoy the rest of your day.
Peace out, Tribe Scout and Ken.